Welcome to the Tech Blog Writer Podcast, your guide to future tech trends and innovation in a language you understand. Now, over to your host, Neil Hughes.
Welcome back to the Tech Blog Writer Podcast. Now, as regular listeners will know, with this podcast, I'm on a one-man mission to look at the tech behind the buzzwords and highlight real-world use cases. I also want to use this show to free you from your echo chambers and embrace diversity of thought and maybe, just maybe, change your worldview a little too. I always say on this podcast that technology works best when it brings people together. And although certain elements of the media would like to keep us all divided, my daily conversations with tech leaders from all over the world is more than enough proof of how we're all working together seamlessly now. On the show recently, we've had the guys from Eternity, Definity, Elf, Monero, Lisk, and the inspirational Tammy Camp, who spoke about her time at Stellar, and obviously now with Stranghold and working with IBM. So for today's podcast, I wanted to explore the world of blockchain and crypto again and speak with Tamar Salant from Neo. Speaking of Neo, how many of you remember when it was called Antshares? But I invited Tamar on the show today to discuss blockchain in Asia, the progress of blockchain in developing countries, women in the blockchain industry, and the evolution so far in this space. And of course, when and how mainstream adoption is going to come from. So buckle up and hold on tight as I beam your ears all the way to Shanghai in China so we can speak with Tamar Salant from Neo. So a massive warm welcome to the show. Can you tell the listeners a little about who you are and what you do?
Hi, Neil. Well, thank you so much for having me on the podcast today. My name is Tamar Salant. I'm the Global Business Development Manager at Neo Smart Economy, better known as just as Neo. I grew up in Israel. I have a background in tech and government. I worked for Israeli startups, and then for the Israeli Ministry of Foreign Affairs as a data analyst. In 2015, I moved to China with the Israeli diplomatic mission. Came here to work for the Israeli consulate here in Shanghai, where I'm currently based. And after a while, I decided it's time to pursue my long, geeky interest of many, many years, which was blockchain, and decided to join the field full time.
Fantastic. What a great backstory as well. I mean, but Neo is one of the biggest and most exciting projects in the blockchain and crypto space, and some listeners will know all about it. Well, I'm conscious that there are maybe a few out there that are hearing about it for the very first time. So just to ensure that everyone is on that right page, can you help all the listeners understand exactly what problems Neo solves and maybe offer a use case which also highlights the role of the token of Neo as well?
Absolutely. Well, I completely agree. You know, it is one of the exciting projects that we see out there in the blockchain space. Neo, formerly known as Antshares, is building actually a compliant-ready smart economy. So we have both our testnet and obviously our mainnet up and running. We are seeing over, I'd say, 80 decentralized applications at the moment at various stages that are being built on top of the Neo blockchain. So Neo is a blockchain project itself, meaning the technology is out there, projects can be built on top of the decentralized blockchain that we have. We are basically building a smart economy. What does that actually mean? We're focusing it on three main pillars, if you will, being digital identity, digital assets, and smart contracts. And really looking into the shifts and the movement of blockchain and what this great technology can bring to the world. We're also looking at real life use cases and really focusing on, again, on these three main pillars to try to understand how they interact with each other and what we can do in terms of building a smart economy. We have, you know, different applications that are focusing either on supply chain and healthcare and gaming, data and compliance, and just various themes out there that we see people that have interest, and we really see the advantages that blockchain technology can bring to these specific fields. And obviously, it's a work in progress. So every day, you know, we're hearing about more and more projects that are building on top of Neo. We ourselves are mostly focused on the ecosystem itself. So each project based on Neo, built on Neo, powered by Neo, if you will, is its own project, obviously. And we are doing everything, you know, to ensure that this blockchain is the fastest. You know, we're looking at a TPS of 1,000 transactions per second at the moment. We're looking at a different consensus mechanism than maybe what most people know out there, which is proof of work or proof of stake. So we have our own consensus mechanism, which is DBFT, and just various technical, unique advantages that we basically have.
Now, words such as blockchain and crypto are in danger of being overhyped, but I want to highlight how this technology is and will continue to change the world for the better and actually make it fit for a digital age and that Web 3.0 era. I also want people listening to think beyond their own geographical borders or continents. So to begin with, can you tell me more about how blockchain in Asia and the excitement behind this technology that's gathering at the moment?
Absolutely. That is a fantastic question. I think Asia has been going through a very rapid, exciting phase through this couple of years when it comes to accepting and implementing new technologies. We'll see a rapid growth in anything that has to do with IoT, fintech, cashless payments, and obviously mobile penetration that kind of kicked this off. So the concepts behind blockchain technology, as well as we know them, are not new concepts, but the way they're being implemented and the way they're being structured these days are certainly new, revolutionary, if you will, concepts. And I think when it comes to adoption and when it comes to having the right mindset, Asia has proven to be a leader in revolutionary technology. So if we're looking again at fintech and IoT and now blockchain, I think both the mindset and the mentality, as well as adoption and implementation to the masses, again, we're looking at very large populations, and we also are looking at people that have and want to be on the front line when it comes to adopting new technologies. And I think the space, especially in blockchain, is so interesting when it comes to Asia. And we do see Southeast Asian countries really leading the space. If it's China, obviously, if it's Japan, if it's South Korea, Malaysia, and Indonesia that are becoming new hubs as well. We are seeing a lot of both developers and community interests coming from these countries. I think even looking back at 2015, when I just first came to China, we saw mainstream media talk about blockchain technology. Now, at that time, I think mainstream media in the West wasn't as much focus on blockchain as much as it was on AI and VR and fintech and what have you not. And the articles that were coming out on blockchain, I think, were more negative in a way. But I think mainstream media here in Asia was very much excited about what was going on from an enterprise level, from different applications that were starting to pop up. And I think this also gave that big boost to the technology here in the region.
Now, I've spoken on this podcast recently about how developing countries have traditionally been neglected, and many seldom think about how much of the world has no access to things that many take for granted, such as access to a bank. So in your opinion, what role will blockchain play in developing countries? And can you also possibly help people listening visualize how it could actually reshape the world as we know it, and for the better too?
Absolutely. I think a lot of people in the industry, a lot of people in the global community are looking at blockchain technology and cryptocurrencies as a way to reach and help exactly these people out there in the world in developing countries. A lot of people like to use the phrase banking the unbanked when we're talking about developing countries. It's true that using cryptocurrencies has the potential to help so many of these people, again, who have no access to banking systems, who have no daily or weekly reach to their local bank. And of course, when looking at countries that are suffering from financial crisis, big and small, I think looking at what's going on today in the world, whether it's Turkey, Venezuela, or Zimbabwe, that's where we're seeing people that are turning to cryptocurrencies as a way to ensure that their pension, that their salary, that their hard-worked money is secure in a way. When financial crisis obviously hit these regions, you know, the local currencies plunge or skyrocket, depends on the situation. And this is causing panic, and this is leading to terrible situations. But I think also not only during times of crisis do we see developing countries looking at blockchain technology and cryptocurrencies. And I think when we're looking at people that are not registered, and when we look at people that might have assets under their name that are not traditional assets, but maybe they have a farm, maybe they have some cattle, maybe they do have different assets that the government or other institutions are not recording them as assets, but with blockchain technology, you can have them registered in a digital way and as a digital asset, actually. If you have everything recorded on the blockchain, that is immune to different disasters that might occur, being natural disasters, wars, loss of information. And I think these developing countries, again, because of instability, can really appreciate the many advantages that blockchain technology can have. And I think banking the unbanked, and again, developing countries from an infrastructure level can really benefit from this.
So in the tech industry, I'm a big believer in diversity of thought being essential. And there have been wide reports of a lack of women in tech. But thankfully, I'm beginning to see a reversal in this trend. And I recently spoke to Tammy Camp, who is truly inspirational, has been in the world of crypto since back in 2011. But can you tell me more about your opinion about how you're seeing women actually leading the way in blockchain?
I think that women in blockchain is such an important topic, and I'm so happy that we are discussing it. I have been involved in blockchain since late 2011. We did not see as many women as we see today. I think that, again, women in blockchain as a topic shouldn't be its own topic. I know a lot of people out there like to complain and talk about how there aren't a lot of women in the space, but it's not exactly true. I do see a lot of great women out there leading projects, being part of teams, thought leaders in the space. But I feel like this is becoming an issue where people are starting to stress over the fact that there's a lack of women rather than focusing on the leading women in the space. So I think there is this imbalance when it comes to focus on women. I think tech in general, you know, sadly does not have a 50-50 ratio when it comes to women in tech teams. Blockchain is no different in that sense. We are not seeing that 50-50 ratio in blockchain teams. We are not seeing as many women leading in the space as we see men. But I think, again, there's also a focus on the fact that there aren't a lot of women rather than focusing on the women who are in the space. I think one of the great things about blockchain is this is a new field which is attracting a lot of different talent, a lot of people from different backgrounds. And this diversity is what makes this such an exciting space to be at the moment. And I think when we're looking at projects and when we're looking at talent out there, we shouldn't be judging due to race or gender or geographical location, but we should be judging by quality at the end of the day. I know there is a lot of talk of blockchain being a boys club and that we should fight this, that we only should invest in women-only teams or women-led projects only. And I think that is a big mistake. I think when we're looking at basic concepts like inclusion and inclusion in tech specifically, we should be focusing again on quality. And I think once we move from there aren't enough women in tech, rather than look at these great leaders in tech and we also have women up there, that's when understanding and that's when inclusion truly happens.
Yeah, I completely agree. And I think diverse teams are so important now. And if you haven't got a diverse team, how can you serve your diverse audience? You know, that's the way I see it. I have spoken in the past about how I've watched a video of Bill Gates explaining the internet and email on the Letterman show back in 1995. And the host and the audience just laughed and mocked Bill Gates back then. And in many ways, that's exactly how I feel when I talk about crypto here in 2018, like some kind of heretic. I mean, just like the internet in 1995, blockchain and crypto is still in its infancy. But the pace of change is starting to move at breakneck speed now. So how do you see the evolution in this space, you know, so far and beyond?
I absolutely love that example because I think it does such a good job in demonstrating how big technological implementations actually happen. There is a lot of urge and a lot of expectations currently at the blockchain and cryptocurrency scene to have everything up and running right now, the faster, the better. Which is never the case, especially when it comes to technology. I think when we look, you know, throughout history, every big technological implementation, whether it's the internet, whether it's mobile, you know, and if we even go way, way back to canals and railroad systems, as the economist Carlota Perez wrote in a terrific book, every big revolution, you know, it takes time to build. If we're looking at the adaptation, if we're looking at implementation, bringing in governments and regulators, it takes time. You don't just go poof and you have, you know, everything decentralized. And I think this is also the case with current decentralized applications and blockchains. I do see big players coming into the space like governments and regulators. We do see a lot of hype around projects, enterprises. Everyone is kind of turning to blockchain technology to have a better understanding how this can happen and how this can happen today, tomorrow, right now. It does take time. If we're looking, you know, even at the internet, until the internet reached the stage that it got to today, if we're looking, you know, with all the minor and major changes that occurred, we can't even remember today, you know, what we did before e-commerce, what did we do before digital journalism. But it took time, and it takes implementation, and it takes adoption, and it takes time to gradually build it in the right and proper way. And this same rule applies to cryptocurrencies as well. I mean, obviously, we're all very super excited about the potential and what can be achieved. But truth be told, we're not there in terms of the technology. So a lot of projects are talking about what they will do and how they will do it, but they don't always use the right technology, and then they themselves have not built the up and running projects that they claim to be building, which is causing a bit of a stress actually in the industry, because it's causing a lot of noise. And instead of focusing on building it and having, you know, actual roadmap and reaching the goals that each project is setting for themselves, it's kind of causing a lot of hype around something that at the moment is still not achievable. I think this crazy rush, and maybe even impatience in a way, is leading to some bad results out there. It's leading to mediocre projects. It's leading to bad reputation, bad solution even, and just creating, again, this unnecessary noise. But I do think, you know, as regulators come in, as enterprises enter, and as more knowledge and talent and diversity, again, enter the space, I think this is what will bring implementation, and will bring this blockchain revolution that everyone wants to see.
Yeah, I completely agree. And I think you hit the nail on the head there when you said the word impatience. There's just so much impatience in the industry at the moment. And the key to success of blockchain and crypto, of course, is mass adoption, ensuring that everyone comes along for the ride. But do you think eventually the tech will just become invisible and mainstream audiences will be using it, but without actually realizing it? And how and when do you see mainstream adoption occurring?
Oh, absolutely. I am a firm believer that we will see that. And to my opinion, in my opinion, that will be the final test to see if this technology actually succeeds. At the moment, my grandmother cannot go to the supermarket and use a cryptocurrency to purchase her daily loaf of bread. But I do believe that they will come, and I do believe that she herself won't even know that she is using cryptocurrency to buy that loaf of bread at the local supermarket. But I think once that happens, that's when we really get to mass adoption. I think that once we ensure transparency, when we ensure easy and user-friendly applications out there, because at the moment, let's be honest, a lot of the applications out there are very complicated. You need to download certain things, you need to log on, you need to have various expertise almost in order to use your cryptocurrency, and this is not what this is about. And I think when big companies start implementing transparent, if you will, solutions, again, which are based on blockchain, even if they use a token and even if they don't, that's when mass adoption will happen. Again, once we have also regulators come in, because it really goes hand in hand. You have to have adoption. You need to have regulators ensuring it, because people will not be risking doing something that is illegal or is problematic, or they are not exactly sure how it will be regarded. Again, I'm talking about the masses here, obviously. And until a lot of the gray areas that we see with cryptocurrencies, I think, are settled and have a clear understanding, mass adoption will not come. Well, we are on our way. I am very much confident about that. I do have faith, but again, it is a matter of right implementation until we get the results we want to have.
Now, I always say at the end of this show that technology works best when it brings people together. And on this podcast, I try and expand people's worldview and perceptions and those traditional stereotypes. So I've got to ask you, because I recently read about how you were traveling to South America recently, and you visited a number of blockchain projects and communities. So can you tell me more about some of those initiatives, talent, amazing developers, and inspiring entrepreneurs that you encountered? And as someone working in the heart of the industry, what excites you most about this space?
Yes. So I have a personal connection with South America. Actually, the reason I got interested in blockchain was back in 2011, I was hearing from family and friends living in Argentina about the use of Bitcoin. Now, Argentina, unfortunately, is a country that suffers from a lot of hyperinflation, economic crisis, and the trust in traditional financial systems and banking system is very different from what trust that many people in other countries, whether it's in certain countries in Europe or the United States, have in their traditional systems. Now, back in 2011, family and friends were telling me how they were getting paid in Bitcoin or paying for freelance work with Bitcoin because it was so hard to bring in and out of the country US dollars, and because the use of Argentinian peso at the time was very problematic. So people were looking for different ways to get paid and to pay for freelance work, especially. So US dollars was not an option due to regulations and due to problems with bringing in and out of the country. And people were actually starting to use Bitcoin. Now, this was 2011, 2012. I had some friends who were mining Bitcoin at the time, but it was just some of my geek friends and myself as a hobby who were looking into this. But no one was actually looking at Bitcoin from the people I knew as an actual form of payment. And I found that fascinating. And I found that concept of, using Bitcoin, using this digital currency that does not go through middlemen, that is not objected to, that is not influenced by governments or by different situations, fascinating. I understood technology, I understood P2P technology as well, and I just found the concept fascinating. So when I traveled to South America a couple of months ago, I had that urge in me to come and see live what was going on in the region. Again, I think also South America is very similar to Asia in that mentality and that adoption of new technologies. If we're looking in mobile penetration, if we're looking to use kind of e-commerce, South America is one of the fascinating regions to look at. And I think there is so much good talent in South America. Again, now that we're seeing that a lot of these economies are much more stable, people are looking at their current economy and looking to the future and saying, okay, how can we ensure the situation continues? And I do think the mentality is there. When it comes to blockchain, people really understand how this technology can help. I met so many enthusiastic entrepreneurs. Some of them are working on blockchain projects full time. Some of them are doing this as part of working at big enterprise or big corporations. And they really do understand the potential. I think what I was mostly excited was people that are focusing and different decentralized applications or different use cases to cut down the usage of paper when it comes to voting, when it comes down to fighting voter fraud, when it comes to listing property, when it comes to giving people across the region that may be living in remote areas basic rights, actually. Cutting out the middlemen and giving these people more opportunities, if it's for banking, if it's for transferring of assets, if it's for transparency with their legal with their local government. I found that just fascinating. And obviously, there are a lot of problems that can be tackled with blockchain. And these people know that. And these people are, again, mostly looking at their own countries, but afterwards are looking to see how they can import these ideas outwards. South America is a lot of the economies in South America are based on trade, or based on import and export, and globalization is really a key player here. And once you cut out the middleman, if you have someone who's manufacturing, for example, t-shirts in a factory in China, and he's shipping it over to his retail stores in Panama and Argentina and Brazil, he's going through a lot of middlemen. He doesn't always know what is going on. He doesn't always know what is happening with the boats. He doesn't always know what happens with the actual products. And suddenly with blockchain, making all this information transparent and again, cutting out the middleman, which are taking a big chunk of his revenue, I think is really going to make a difference.
Fantastic. What a huge thank you for coming on the show today. But before I do let you go, can I just ask that you remind the listeners of where they can find out more information about Neo, check out your white papers, roadmaps, or just get involved with a growing community that you've got there and discuss developments, or even contact a member of your team around after hearing our conversation today.
Absolutely. So NEO is an open source public blockchain. We focus very much on our community, whether it's global community or our developer community, which is also global for that sense. We have a very active Discord channel, very active GitHub. We have our website that holds all documentation, our white paper, we have our events. We are very much active on social media. We also have an open email policy. Anyone who's listening, you know, feel free to contact me through LinkedIn, through email. I'd love to further discuss. I'd love to answer questions. I love getting in touch with people from the community and from out of the community and see what we can do together.
Well, like I said at the beginning of the show, NEO is one of the most exciting projects in the blockchain and crypto space right now. But having listened to you there, I think your story is equally as exciting and inspirational. And I love how you've traveled through South America and across Asia, and you've witnessed firsthand how technology does work best when it brings people together, and you're actually bringing the global community together too. So a big thank you for coming on and sharing that story with me today. I love chatting with Tamar, because I'm a UK-based podcaster that speaks to people all over the world and attends some of the biggest tech events, but I never ever get tired of hearing and sharing stories from people like Tamar, who speak of how technology is not only bringing the world closer together, but it's also changing the world for the better too. By contrast, whenever you read the tech news, it's always AI is stealing jobs, crypto scams, and I think this can taint your worldview. And it's so important to remember that bad news might sell, and good news doesn't. And that's why we're being spoon-fed this information. Maybe it's just because I remember being brought up listening to Devon in Knight Rider saying the words, "One man can make a difference." But I think we should all start looking at the positive impacts of technology, what it's having on the world. And also, if people are listening to this in 165 different countries and we're all learning together, that's got to be a great thing, right? But enough of me preaching my sermon on the mic. The reason this Daily Tech podcast works is the eclectic mix of guests that we have and the direct engagement from you, the audience. So it's time once again for me to pass the virtual microphone over to you, because I want you to share your insights and your expertise. And you can do that by emailing me directly, techblogwriter@outlook.com, or of course tweeting me at Neil C. Hughes. So keep those messages coming in, and I'll return tomorrow with another great guest from the world of technology. But it's time for me to go. So thanks for listening, and until next time, don't be a stranger.
Thanks for listening to the Tech Blog Writer Podcast. Until next time, remember, technology is best when it brings people together.